afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. If you haven't been here before, this is Dr. Sandy Ballmer from Baggett's Hospital in Norwich. With him is Debbie, his office manager. And I think you all know him. I think 90% of his patients are here. He will have office hours after the class. That's why Debbie's here with the insurance card. But anyway, he's going to talk to us about whatever. And we're also being filmed. Last semester, we were able to be filmed. It was shown on the college website. They had more hits than they could ever imagine with his talk. So we're doing it again. They've asked Dr. Farmer if they could film again, and we are going to film again. So you'll be able to see this on their website in a few months. So without further ado, it's yours.
Thank you, everybody.
Can you hear me now? Perfect. I was trying to be high tech, but let me just go low tech.
This is like my third or fourth time I've been here. We majority of the time talk about disease, we talk about complications, we talk about medications, and we talk about side effects of medications and how to balance this out. Today, we have like a little different tune. We'll sort of talk about at least trying not to get sick. I think in my business, I think we are sort of moving towards other ways of not getting sick. So we may have to talk about disease, but we still sort of have this little panacea of it. It's a nice little circle where you feel well and really well and prevent disease. About a year ago, Dr. Murthy was with the Obama administration, and one of the big things they talked about at that time was loneliness. It is a very tough topic to talk about. The more you think about it, the more you actually understand it and how it relates to disease is really complex, but it is a very, very common reason why illness is happening. So the more technical term is social determinants of health rather than anything else. And talking a little bit about loneliness, just to start off the conversation, and then we'll sort of go into a little bit more into how to prevent a couple of the illnesses that we commonly see, which are commonly happening in patients over the age of 65. That is going to be the theme of this afternoon. And then you can raise your hands at any time, ask me a question. And I think, you know, we do about a 45-minute sort of back and forth. And then if you have special questions, then we can go with that. Cigna, about 2 days ago, Cigna is a big insurance company. About 2 days ago, sort of following on that pattern of loneliness, did a 20,000 people survey. This was not age versus gender. This was just the general population in the United States of America. They did a survey. About 53% of patients, or sort of 53% of the individuals, said they had not had a meaningful face-to-face interaction within the last month or longer. And that is so huge. And this is why this kind of an environment where people meet each other, talk to each other, more opportunity to sort of at least mingle is such an important concept in just determining health. Just by being here, we never considered, you know, social determinants of health as very big. We always thought everything was biology. You know, you got an infection, you got an autoimmune disease, you got a cancer. These are illnesses, but social determinants of health are probably 50% of the cause of the illnesses that we talk about. So if we can sort of work on this 50% social determinants of health, we can actually avoid some of these illnesses. And this loneliness then sort of, you know, translates into depression, translates into anxiety. And if you are a little bit depressed, you have some degree of anxiety, and if you have a heart attack, you have a 30 to 40% higher risk of dying. It is a dramatic thing if you have a mood not intentionally. Life happens. And I think that is why, you know, couple of the things they talk about is so loneliness is sort of in the same category as mood disorder and depression, and it is very difficult to sort of talk about it. About 30 years ago, when we talked about depression, it was considered, what are these people talking about? Nobody wanted to sort of accept the concept that depression really exists. You know, the question was, is it all in my head? It's a true chemical imbalance that happens, which is truly real, and that leads to disease. And same thing is with loneliness. I think Dr. Murthy started the conversation of loneliness, and I think it has really translated into sort of step one. You know, we have to be aware of what his theory was. He said, we have to be aware that these things happen. And then if you are lonely, accept the fact that there is some degree of loneliness. All of us, just like mood disorder, hypertension, no matter any illness you take, we don't have a ICD-10 code for loneliness, but I think it really is a very, very big factor in determining how your outcome is going to be, just like I showed you the outcome for the cardiac disorder. And then, you know, sort of not fighting it, but, you know, so once you have the awareness that yes, loneliness exists, about 50% of people do not have a meaningful conversation with somebody in the last month, and then accepting it, okay, now that maybe I'm in the category, maybe I'm not in the category, and then sort of the compassion that it happens, and I think that is the key to sort of moving from the doing no action and sort of just not taking action, not even looking at loneliness, and then sort of addressing it. So we are sort of, over the next year, 2 years, there is going to be a lot more talk about how to address this huge, huge social determinant, just like we addressed with mood disorder and depression about 30 years ago. Couple of thoughts. I think you guys are doing a great job. I think sort of some recommendations that came out of that was, one, reach out and join groups. I think this is a very, very good way of doing it. Reach out and join groups. Get to know yourself a little bit better. That is huge, you know, doing a self inventory. Where am I? You know, that goes with the same concept of acceptance and compassion. You know, there is no reason to beat yourself up, but the idea being, get to know yourself a little bit better. Talk to someone when you're out and about, you know? I don't know, it's not easy. I have to tell you, I stand here, I have to really prep myself up. I talk a lot in the office, but I think you'll see when I go out for a gathering meeting, I have difficulty in, you know, again, we are all different. You need to know where you sort of fit into. Less technology, I know everybody's pushing technology. I don't know. Some technology is good. I don't know how much Netflix you watch. The more Netflix you watch, the more mood disorder you're gonna get. I don't know. This is this new thing coming out. If you're spending more than 2 hours a day watching Netflix, it's a problem. Please come and join one of these groups. I think so. We are really realizing, you know, we think it's great. My point is, oh, I watched binge watch from A to Z. I don't know, whatever show you watch, Lord of the Rings, I don't know. The idea being very similar. If you're watching a lot of TV or watching a lot of Netflix, I think that is a indicator that something, again, I'm not making this up, this is actually, they're studying this, you know, the time you spend on technology may not be a good thing, you know, again, you know, something to think about. We talk a little bit about time to reflect. I think that goes same thing with getting to know yourself, but time to reflect, you know, do I have friends, do I make the effort, do I invite somebody? It is a chore, I really think, you know, having a social conversation, having a social determinant is huge. And I think the last thing they talk about is help others. I think helping somebody else really, really, really sort of makes you feel good, makes the other person feel good. I think everybody feels better. Just sort of moving a little tangent away from this concept, when they studied longevity, so we go from loneliness to longevity. You know, which people live longer? So this has been studied actually pretty deeply. I'm not sure if anybody watches TED Talks on YouTube, something to think about if you put in longevity. Three things they talk about. So there are three groups that tend to live the longest. Out of which two groups are women, and they had to do it. They couldn't be gender specific, that women definitely live longer. So how do we figure out how women live longer? So two groups were women and one group was men. So one set of group comes from Japan, in a small town, small village in Japan, where these women actually have a social system. As you probably know, men die about 6 years younger than women do, sort of on a geographic basis. So these are all sort of women that are single. And what they have figured out is, if they have support system and they help each other out, that's the concept of helping each other out. They all tend to live, a lot of them tend to live over the age of 100, and they take care of each other during that process. So longevity, by helping each other out, having sort of some sort of compassion, having a group, is really, really helpful. The second group is a bunch of men from a town in Italy. They never retire. So they make wine, they bicycle, wherever they make wine, they make wine, they're not looking a lot of it too, but so they bicycle and then deliver the wine to wherever they need to, they never retire. So something to be said about, you know, work, function, where, you know, where we work, the camaraderie that is created. And then the final group is from Utah, a bunch of sort of women, sort of that is again predominantly women, but there's men also, which pray together. So the idea is helping each other out, staying as active, and then finding a common true north, common goal, sort of where they go to church, they are very religious. So there is each of these things gives us an idea is for a meaningful life, these are sort of some of the things that we can all think about. All right, so that was my spiel on loneliness. Now that we are depressed, let's move on to the next one. Did I cause depression? No, I didn't. So, a couple of other things we sort of I brought up. You know, I'm a rheumatologist. We want people to move. We want people to be active. But we give a lot of tough medications. We give a lot of immunosuppressants. People who have rheumatoid arthritis, people who have psoriasis, people who have lupus, we are giving these very, very good medicines, but by in the process of giving those medicines, we are suppressing their immune system. So a couple of things that I would like to talk about today, they are rheumatology related, but not directly rheumatology related, is how to prevent two big infections that we can or possibly see in somebody who's over the age of 65 and or has an autoimmune disease. And I think one is shingles and one is pneumonia. And I think the reason I brought this up is that a couple of new recommendations that you can learn and you can sort of use it. Shingles, anybody's had shingles? So this is what we see. It is average about, so they talk about 1 million people in the United States are gonna get shingles every year. That's a lot of people. So step one is, 1 million people are gonna get shingles. Out of that, as we age, incidence of shingles goes up. So from the group between 50 and 59 they've looked at versus 60 and 69 versus 70 and 70 over the age of 80, your risk of shingles actually keeps going up. So there is no decline in the risk of shingles, it actually goes up exponentially. So it's a huge, huge problem. 1 million people getting shingles every year, and as we age, as we live longer, not that I want everybody to live longer, your risk of shingles is gonna go up. So there are sort of, does anybody know what shingles is? Thank you. So shingles is nothing but a reactivation of the virus that causes chickenpox. So I think majority of us have had chickenpox. So when you get chickenpox, it's caused by a virus called varicella zoster. So what happens is when you get chickenpox, those little vesicles that occur on your body, they penetrate from your skin, they penetrate your fatty tissue, and then attach to your nerves. But you don't see all this, you just see the rash, and then that virus then travels, suppose it's in your arm, and then it travels all the way to your dorsal ganglia in and around the spine area, and it hangs up there. It hangs up there for a while, till an event happens, till your immune system is suppressed, or till you don't have enough sort of antibodies to prevent this from happening, and then it, what we call reactivation of that chickenpox happens, and you get this really, really nasty, really nasty rash, a lot of pain, severe pain, as you mentioned. It is probably one of the worst pains. Some people have correlated my shingles pain was worse than my cancer pain, was worse than the childbirth pain. So it is very nasty because it aggravates your nerves. And not only that, after the shingles rash goes away, there is something called as post-herpetic neuralgia. It is, the shingles is gone, but the nerve is still angry, and it causes you to have pain for at least about a year or even longer, even after the shingles is gone. So it is a huge sort of problem. My point is, 1 million people with shingles, nasty rash, post-herpetic neuralgia. So this causes what we call a lot of disability. This is, you know, you just do not feel well, and then it sort of brings your mood down, and then the whole concept about depression, sort of that sort of, it's a cycle that happens. And post-herpetic neuralgia can happen in about 20% of patients. So I don't know, million people, 200,000 will have this chronic pain for about a year or even longer, and then have a miserable life after that. Yes.
If you didn't have chicken pox,
yeah.
Are you eligible for shingles?
No, you are not eligible if you have not. So there is a different challenge over there. If you've never had chicken pox, which is again, we have some of the younger kids that never get chicken pox. I think our generation, probably nearly everybody has had chicken pox because it was so rampant. Some people have had chicken pox, but they never sort of remember it because they may have had a very minor rash and not a full-blown rash. It is the newer generation when they get some sort of vaccination against the chicken pox that are not getting chicken pox. But you are right, if you've never had chicken pox, you cannot get shingles. Because the virus has to live in your nervous system to sort of get reactivated. If it never lived in your system, it can't get reactivated.
And we just got yesterday, ironically, we're talking about that, the new shingles vaccine,
yes,
which supposedly is 90% more effective, and
thank
it
you.
Takes two shots.
Absolutely correct.
And expensive if you don't have insurance.
It is expensive, but I think they put the whole story together, how much miserable you're going to be and how much you're ready to pay. That's how they make the price. I don't know that. So the whole idea being you get really miserable. Yes.
If you had the shot, let's say 5 years ago,
yeah,
are you supposed to get a second shot now?
That's my million-dollar question, and I will answer that in a minute, all right? Yes.
Now, is my understanding that this new shot or series of shots is okay for people who are not eligible for live vaccines?
Very closely correct. I think only places we are still haven't completely defined is if you're a transplant patient. So that's the only one that we sort of looked at, is because they are not eligible for live vaccines. The post-transplant patients, there is no data on. But other people, depending upon what your reason why, you know, whatever the reason was, I think why you could not get live vaccine, talking to us, we can talk about it sort of at the end, contraindication and why you should think about it.
Thank you.
So a couple of things we just want to highlight. Shingles, when it happens in your face and the eye, really, really miserable. Really, really miserable. If you see a rash coming on your face, your head like this, go to the hospital. Because you need an eye doctor. You need to sometimes get IV antivirals. That is really sick. And then there is another condition called called Ramsay-Hunt syndrome, is where the shingles happens inside your ear. Really nasty, really painful. You get a Bell's palsy, but it's worse than the Bell's palsy. Your recovery rate is not that great. So again, so those are the two things I like to highlight. And some people, when they get these shingles on their face or head area, the retina inside the eye can get angry, and then you can actually lose vision. So those are sort of, I need to highlight, if you get the dermatome over here, you know, people will get it here. It involves one side, usually one nerve, but it can be all the way from here. We've seen it from the back, all the way down to the toes, all the way down to the big toe. We've seen it, you know, we see a lot in the sort of the breast line area, groin area, you'll see it on the arm area. So any nerve, any place you have a nerve, it just follows the nerve dermatome, usually never crosses the midline. And I think that is how we differentiate it. You get all these tiny little vesicles, they never cross the midline. Initially, you can have pain, burning sensation, and then pop after 2 or 3 days later, you get this rash. One more thing I would like to say is, when you get the rash, the recommendation is within less than 72 hours, you should try and get those antivirals. That is when they are most effective. If it is after 72 hours, it may not be as effective. So the advantage of the antivirals, have a really big advantage. If you take it on time, one, you have less misery. Two, the rash goes away sooner. Three, your risk of post-herpetic neuralgia goes down quite a bit. So I think there is this, the reason for activation, the reason to go to a walk-in clinic or somewhere, there is a really good reason. If you think you have shingles, there is a very, very good enough reason to make that trip to the walk-in clinic rather than waiting a long time or whatever. So less than 72 hours is the magic. We have three different kinds of meds, and nearly all of them work really well. Some are easier to take 3 times a day. See the song for that. shingles pain is worse than that. So the treatment is usually 7 days. You start it right away within 7 to 2 hours. After 7 days, they get antivirals and usually it is gone. Sometimes the question comes up is, doc, I've got already the shingles. Should I get a vaccine or not? So let's sort of move towards the vaccine story now. And the answer is yes. You wait about 2 months and then you go get the vaccine, because once the body settles down, then you go get the vaccine. So a couple of questions came up over here. I'm going to sort of address that. We have two different kinds of vaccine. So one is a live vaccine. It's called Zostrix, which has been around for about the last 7, 8, 9, 10 years. It actually is live virus. It has these tiny little, not chickenpox, but a virus that is not as angry and as active as chickenpox, but a sort of modified version of the virus, where you take the little live virus and you get this small, like a small little dose. It's 60,000 little cells that come out, and then your body's supposed to develop this antibody towards that, and so you don't get shingles again. Effective, about 50 to 70% effective. That was the whole story. It was 50, just the problem for it was only 50 to 70% effective. It was expensive. And the other big issue was you could not get revaccinated again. It was only approved for one shot. And so sort of, but the immunity only lasted about 5 to 7 years, and after that, what? And if you were over the age of 70, it wasn't as good. So the recommendation initially came out as it was best if you were between 60 and 69. That is what the biggest bang for the buck. The next biggest bang for the buck was between 50 and 60, and then after 70 was the least sort of bang for the buck. So there was a little, a lot of little things that we could have done better. And then the new vaccine came out called Shingrix. And the other thing was the Zostrix was sub-Q. It wasn't inside the muscle, it was just in the fatty tissue. You got the shot, and the Shingrix is intramuscular. A little bit more painful, causes a little more reaction, but way, way, way better. Like you said, close to like nine. If you were between the ages of 60 and 69, it's actually closer to like 96, 97%. And so it's all, everybody's in the 90%. My point is, but the biggest bang for your buck, again, you get is between 60 and 69. And then at 4 years, so like the other vaccine, the immunity just waned off. With this vaccine, the immunity after 4 years have still been shown to be, it's been out, they've been tested at 4 years, still seems to be very good. So you are actually, this is a much, much better vaccine. And at least to the best of my understanding, over the next 3, 4 years, once there is enough production, the other vaccine may not be used at all. Unless there is for some reason you're going to use the other one that'll still be available but won't be commonly used. So your question was, if you've had the Zostrix, should you get the new shingles vaccine? And the answer is yes, because the immunity wanes off, and they say, I don't think they give a time, but you could get it at any time, because the other ones after 3 or 4 years you could actually see the immunity wear off. So I don't think there's a guideline on that, but if you've had it within the last 3 years, if it's more than 3 years, you should definitely consider getting it. And I think that is going to be sort of the game plan, was understand what shingles is, severity of shingles, two vaccines, one not as effective now, and Shingrix is the new vaccine, which is two shots, and it's about 2 months apart. The longest you can do is 6 months apart, if you ever have to have a reaction or something like that. Make sure you take some Benadryl, make sure you take some Tylenol, so you do not sort of get a big reaction. So that was the shingles, so yes?
If you don't remember if you've had chickenpox, is there a blood test to see if you have the virus?
So the recommendation there is probably not to do the blood test, just get the vaccine, because the likelihood is so huge. I think at least the book says there is no value in getting a varicella zoster titer, because that doesn't mean anything, because the immunity could have waned off and you could have had shingles before, chickenpox before, right? So the test only tests your antibody. It doesn't tell you whether you had chickenpox or not. It just tells you, did your body make the antibody against it? So it's not very helpful, the test. Yes?
How new is the new shot?
October 2017. It is brand new, yeah. And that is why the production is so sometimes you have to wait, and I think that is why the other vaccine is still available, because this is going to be one of those changing, like, you know, sort of, you know, changes the course of how the disease is. You can be able to really get a handle on shingles. Yes?
I've seen on TV the ads for these lawyers who say that now the shingles vaccine is giving people shingles, and if you've had this reaction, sign up with them and they'll get your
So the book says that the live vaccine, there was a small chance, extremely small chance. What they've shown is people whose immune system is very suppressed. That is why the whole idea is, yes, it is a live vaccine. You get these really tiny, but majority of the time, what they've shown is recurrence of shingles happens in about 4% of people. So we already know that, at least with the older vaccine. I think that this new one will completely change the course. Yes?
How many times do you get the shingles?
$1 million question. So the theory is, what they have done is they looked at people who were naive, not shingles. So again, there was the 97% we were talking about is these are placebo-controlled groups, never had shingles. So they took, it was a really big study, 13,000 people, half of them got the vaccine and half did not get it. There was a 97% reduction. So to your question, how many times can you get shingles? You technically, the longer you live, your incidence actually keeps going up. Because it's your cell immunity, right? As the immune system gets older, right? As the immune system gets older, your risk of reactivation of disease goes up. Yes?
So, to take off on her question, chickenpox, once you've had it, you won't get it again.
Yes.
But shingles, once you've had it, you can get that again.
4% of people, absolutely correct. Not a huge number, but 4% for a million people, that's a lot of people. 4,000 people will have recurrence, and that is based on the immunity, because the vaccine actually sits dormant in your nerve endings. And that is the real, real challenge. And so people who've never had chickenpox get exposed to somebody who has shingles. Now they are at a very high risk for getting chickenpox. And then the cells, then it's going to hang out all over the body, and then part of that virus is then going to go sit with your dorsal ganglia. Does that sort of make sense?
Yes.
So shingles is not contagious?
Shingles to people who've had chickenpox is not contagious. If they haven't had chickenpox, you are in trouble because it's the virus still hangs out. You can do a Zanx smear, you can look at the virus, and if you are, that is where the challenge comes in. If somebody is immunosuppressed, somebody has had bone marrow transplantation, it is really, when they talk about vaccination a couple of years ago, remember that Disney thing where the measles vaccine sort of, so people had not taken measles vaccine, they went to Disney and all of a sudden we had a measles outbreak. It is really, really challenging because there is something called herd immunity. Enough people have to be vaccinated, and we talked a little bit about that, to sort of make sure that the disease doesn't come out. But people are getting these really fancy treatments, I call it cancer treatments, where their immunity really goes down, and you have to be very careful. So that is where sort of there is this big push at the right time when people are immunosuppressed. At what time do we give them the Shingrix vaccine, which is the dead vaccine, which is a glycoprotein, not dead vaccine, it's made through a tiny molecule of the glycoprotein. It's only a part of the virus which is attached to something that makes you make an immune system. So it's a really fancy, fancy way of making you have a good immune system against that virus. Yes?
I don't know if I ever had chickenpox in a child, my mother never said it, but my kids had chickenpox, and I never got it from them, even though they had it was very bad. So would you suggest that I get the shot?
So my understanding, to the best of my understanding, you probably had chickenpox. If you did not get chickenpox and your kid had really bad chickenpox and you did not get chickenpox, again, this is an assumption, you probably had chickenpox.
And so getting
the
shot would be?
Very reasonable. My point is shingles, again, if you haven't had shingles, probably the best thing to sort of at least think about doing something. Again, cost is a, again, there are some other barriers. Barriers, availability, cost, coverage, you know, there's a couple of other barriers.
But
the
shot about 7 years ago, but that was the shot that was
the old shot, yeah.
Yeah.
So the new recommendation is anybody who's had old shot should get the new shot, because the old shot, after 3 or 4 years, has really got no juice left. It's pooping out. So, all right, so we're gonna move from shingles to something else. Sounds good? Pneumonia? Who likes pneumonia? None of us like pneumonia. That makes you really sick. Sometimes that makes shingles come out because your immune system is so bad that the shingles comes out. So, couple of things about pneumonia. We differentiate, at least doctors differentiate pneumonia into two big kinds. I'll just tell you how we think. We talk about community-acquired pneumonia, and we talk about healthcare-acquired pneumonia. So we're just gonna focus on community-acquired pneumonia. You live in the community and you get pneumonia, we call it community-acquired pneumonia. If you live in a long-term place and you get pneumonia in the hospital, it's called healthcare-associated pneumonia. So community-acquired pneumonia is a really big problem. You know, you get really sick, doctor, sometimes hospital admission, IV antibiotics, all that good stuff, sometimes ICU. So one of the bacteria that causes pneumonia is called as Streptococcus pneumonia, and I think that is why the whole idea why it's called pneumonia, because the bacteria is called Streptococcus pneumonia, and that is why the pneumonia is called pneumonia. But it is only one of the bacteria that causes pneumonia. The good part is we actually have vaccination against this bacteria. So the incidence of pneumococcal pneumonia has gone down, and that is based on vaccination. Nearly everybody sort of vaccinated. Now there is guidelines to vaccinate even young kids, people who have sickle cell disease, people who have other issues, to get them vaccinated. I'm not going to talk about this group of people. I'm going to talk about sort of, you know, 60, 65, where your immune system is sort of, you know, pooping out a little bit. Is going down a little bit. That's where we sort of we talk about pneumococcal pneumonia. Who watches television? Everybody, right? So over the last couple of years, you've seen the ads for Prevnar go up. Haven't you seen the ads for Prevnar go up? There is a reason why the ads for Prevnar went up. And I'll sort of give you a little background. For the longest time, we used to have this different vaccine. It was called the Pneumovax. Pneumovax used to have, there are these whole different kinds of little things that are there on the pneumococcus capsule. There are these little, what we call subtypes, sub-serotypes. And there are different kinds of pneumonia that, sort of, not different kinds of pneumonia. There is a whole bunch of serotypes that cause pneumonia. So somebody came up with 23 serotypes and made up this pneumococcal vaccine. So you could prevent yourself from getting Streptococcus pneumonia by these 23 different kinds of pneumococcal bacteria. Great thing they did. We sort of got vaccinated, and then the recommendations came out that everybody over the age of 65 who hasn't been vaccinated should get vaccinated by pneumococcal pneumonia. Are we clear so far, or are we confused? So we call it P23, right? One way to think about it is P23 has been out for a while. But it does not create a very big immunity, so they have to come up with a new vaccine. They came up with a new vaccine called Prevnar. Prevnar has 13 other serotypes. But these serotypes that they came up with, these are the ones that are more commonly causing the pneumonia. So now we have two pneumonia vaccines. So one is called Prevnar, one is called Pneumovax. Everybody over the age of 65 should have had Pneumovax, the P23. And then Prevnar sort of really re-emerged around 2007-2010, which has got the other, you know, the other coverage of the bacteria. So that has to be given either a year before the pneumococcal vaccine or a year after the pneumococcal vaccine. So this is where it gets a little bit complicated. So now I'm going to complicate life even more. Other countries, because if enough people get the Prevnar, not everybody needs to be vaccinated. Because that covers all the bacteria that hangs around in your nose and you shed them the most. So if enough people get vaccination, there is not enough pneumococcal pneumonia going on, and they have actually shown this decreased incidence. In other developed countries like UK, Germany, they do not give Prevnar anymore. They only give the pneumococcal vaccine. So something, so the new guidelines that may come out at the end of 2018 will actually, may say, I do not know what they will say. They may only say that we need to do one vaccination instead of two vaccinations. So the other place, one vaccine was better than the other, so it took care of the other one out. Here, we may not be giving two vaccinations, we may be only doing one vaccination. So all the other developed countries are actually giving up using the Prevnar vaccine. And I think that is why I think there's been a resurgence of television ads, because we may not be using the other vaccine. And I think that is sort of one thing to think about. And we may actually have much lesser pneumococcal pneumonia going down. And as we talked about, the more healthy you are, the more active you are. And there is a whole list of things that makes you at a higher risk of pneumococcal pneumonia. And I think one of the big ones is alcohol. My point is, if people drink alcohol, they're at a much higher incidence of pneumococcal pneumonia. So I think, one more thing. You know, again, common things, commonly alcohol and smoking. My point is, if you have alcohol and you have smoking, that really increases your incidence of pneumococcal pneumonia. So we talked a little bit about the Shingrix vaccine. You get two shots. And that immunity, my understanding, is supposed to last 10, 12, 13, 14, 15 years. They do not have a revaccination strategy for the Shingrix vaccine, but for the Pneumovax, people may, if they are not diabetic, they don't drink, they don't smoke, they may get the shot every 10 years, possibly, unless they go on to develop some sort of lung disease or chronic disease, then they should get it every 5 years. So this is sort of the complicated part where you have to discuss that with your doctors and how often you get it. And there's a sort of an algorithm. The more illnesses you have, there is this theory that you should more often, at least every 5 years, get the pneumococcal vaccine, versus if you're a really healthy guy, get one, God bless you for the next 20 years, a healthy gal. And then if you're somewhere in the middle, maybe in 10 years, you should consider revaccinating yourself. So I think these are all ways that will prevent you from getting sick, prevent you from seeking care, prevent you from being admitted to the hospital. And I think sort of that was sort of the theme of the talk was, be less lonely, don't get shingles, do not get pneumonia. That's my story. Now we can talk about anything. Yes?
I was given a pneumonia shot when I was in my 40s by our school nurse.
Very good.
But then I developed really bad hives on my arm.
Got it.
And my doctor advised me to avoid a pneumonia shot after that.
Stay healthy. Unless you're so.
In the community where everyone's been vaccinated.
You got it. So that is one huge thing. Community, we let everybody else get vaccinated and stay healthy. Do not drink, do not smoke. No, but that's a very good question. If you have a reaction, right? Nobody in their right mind is going to say, take the shot again. Because if you were to get a systemic reaction, now you're sicker than you were before. And that's the goal here, is not to make you sick.
My doctor said there's no antibody to an allergic reaction to pneumonia vaccine. Mm-hmm. Is that correct? There's no.
That is absolutely correct. But there is a way to figure out. I think in bone marrow transplant patients, there's a way to figure out if they have antibodies to the serotypes that we were talking about. There is a blood test that is available to see if you have antibodies to some of the serotypes that are commonly causing. So you can go the reverse way, not the antibodies to the reaction, but do you have enough antibodies did you make enough antibodies when you first got the shot against the serotypes? Right. Yes?
So how much alcohol is there?
Oh, that's a touchy subject. We talked a little bit about it last night. There is a gender difference. I'm not sure if I want to dip into that. So the gender difference is women are allowed one glass of wine a day, and then I'm allowed a little bit more, so there is a little gender thing going on over there. So I'm not sure if I want to go into gender issues. Yes?
I don't remember exactly when I got my pneumonia shot. We were going on a trip that we had to have. But they said it was a one-time deal, so that's not true?
If you were healthy, it is a one-time deal, technically speaking. Technically speaking, if you're relatively healthy, you do everything right, you don't drink, you don't smoke, you don't have diabetes, you don't do all the right things, it is supposed to be a one-time deal. Okay. But there is a but. There is, the but is, if you get sicker, then you become a little bit more frequent, and then if you're really more sicker, then should it be every 5 years or not? And I
I think the new recommendation that coming in 2000. So the Prevnar, everybody knows Prevnar is only one shot. The other vaccine is only one shot. It's the Pneumovax that we can give you again and again, maybe every 10 years or every 5 years.
Even if you had the first one.
In theory, again, if you are relatively healthy versus So that is where that little conflict comes in, is my point, is if you only had one shot, the question is, should you get the Prevnar and then wait another year and then get again? Like this is where sort of that little personalized medicine comes in, no cookie cutter here again. Yes?
Well, we took it years and years ago, it was probably Prevnar, right?
Pneumovax, years and years ago was Pneumovax, yeah.
Okay, and that you only need one shot.
If you are healthy. So Pneumovax is one shot if you're healthy. Prevnar, no matter whether you're healthy or unhealthy, only get one shot.
Well, I haven't had two shots a
number of years apart. Yeah, a year apart, yeah. No, you are absolutely, no, but really, it only covers, so what I was trying to explain to you is, incidence has gone down as we get more immunization, right? As more immunization happens, as herd immunity develops, the incidence of Streptococcus pneumonia causing pneumonia has definitely gone down over the last 10 to 15 years. Other incidences have gone up, like MRSA has gone up, Staph aureus has gone up, some of the others have gone up because of using antibiotics. Again, this is a complex thing, but this is one very important where mortality used to be pretty high, and now the mortality is not that high because one, we have better antibiotics, two, a lot of people are vaccinated, so even when they get sick, they are not as sick because they have antibodies to fight some of the pneumococcus that is there. And the challenge becomes, you don't need a huge, when somebody has pneumococcal pneumonia or their carriers, it doesn't need a lot of bacteria to go into your lungs to cause them to sort of proliferate and give you what we call a lobar pneumonia, because the whole lobe gets involved and it gives you lobar pneumonia. So this is where the real challenge comes in. If we can have enough immune system, sort of enough immunity, we won't get as sick. And because Debbie and I in our office, we use a lot of medications that suppress immune system, and our patients are at a slightly increased, a little bit more increased risk of infection, and I think that is why we sort of read about it and we dig into it. What else?
A little off, probably not off the system question too much. For health reasons, I'm allowed only Tylenol.
Yes.
And it really doesn't do very much for anything on and whenever I ask, can I take anything else, the answer is always no.
Good answer. You'll live on. You may be in more pain, but you will live on. I think it's a very good answer. We just talked about longevity. That is one of them. Do not take meds. So this is the whole new thing coming out. If you can handle, supposedly, if you can manage, if you can correctly manage pain, right? So this whole pain thing is 20 years old, and again, I'm not sure if you want to sort of go into this whole opioid thing. 20 years ago, we made pain like this fifth vital sign, and you wanted everybody's pain to be really controlled. Pain is pain. I really think pain is pain, and I think medications help, but there is a huge downside, and then whatever people can manage their pain, great. Maybe an injection here and there, maybe some surgical intervention, but I think pain is, I don't know. The more I understand about pain, I tell people hang out with pain. I think hanging out with pain is safer actually than trying to fix that.
And so aspirin is not offered as an alternative to me at all as a relief of arthritis.
Got it. Again, I don't know the details, but aspirin has its own issues.
That's why they say no.
Yes, because aspirin, especially any, so we have a whole bunch of patients who have atrial fibrillation. Everybody's heard about AFib, that's the new magic word. And the whole country has it, not the whole country. 4 or 5 million people have it, but it appears like everybody has it. So everybody's on a blood thinner. So we have to be really careful, and I think that is one of the biggest reasons we do not prescribe too much aspirin or Celebrex. First when Celebrex came out, we were all excited. A lot of people got help. It was better on the GI tract, did not cause enough kidney disease. And then AFib took over, and then everybody's on a blood thinner, Eliquis, Coumadin, I don't know how many, every 5 days a new one comes out, I can't even keep up. And so that is the real big challenge in management of pain, of osteoarthritis in patients who are on a blood thinner, really is a true, true challenge. And I think that's where we go for biofreeze, that's where we go for topical therapy. Some people have TENS units, some people go to physical therapy, some people go swimming. So you are absolutely right. It is a true challenge to not cause side effects. You know, keep you healthy, keep you out of the hospital, because once your GI bleed happens, you go to the hospital, you are not coming out here. You are coming out here, and you're gonna be, this is your new normal, and then something else happens, you go down here, and this is your new normal. And that hospital admission, really, we try really hard. That hospital admission, after a certain age, you never come back here. You just have a new normal.
They want you out as soon as they.
Which is very good. I just said, the new normal is not going to be, so the expectation is my new normal is going to be how I was before I went into the hospital. I think that mentality is good but bad at the same time, because in reality, you are never coming back at the same the way you went in. So that's what the talk today was about. How do we prevent issues that can sort of, simple issues that we can prevent us very easily to being admitted to the hospital. And I think that you probably see the same over the next 5-10 years, you know, especially with the new, what we call the wearables, you know, the Fitbits, the Apple Watch, we are going to be able to, no, really, figure it out maybe a little bit sooner, because there is some data going out that the moment that the Apple Watch will know that your temperature is going to be higher even before you feel it, it'll give you a warning sign, and then sort of we can start the investigation a little bit sooner. Nearly all of us are going to be wearing some sort of a wearable. And that's sort of in the next 3 or 4 years, yes. And it's going to give you your pulse, your temperature. I think temperature is the new big thing. Pulse and temperature have become like the two new big vital signs. I think that, you know, pain is out. At least in my office, pain is out. My point is, I think that created more problems than it helped. But we all have to do it. So that was the story. Yes.
I'm sorry.
You mentioned the hospital.
Yeah.
My key for staying well is don't go to the hospital. My friend of mine went in for a GI bleed, and when he got out, he ended up getting pneumonia, which I'm assuming was from the hospital. So my question is how is it that you can avoid staying out of the hospital if you can just use your primary care physician or home based stuff?
So I think very, very good question. I think some of the new technology will help you with that. I think I go very, very simple. There are 400 vital signs. Blood pressure, pulse, weight, and temperature. Just go back to basics. Make sure those are taken care of, and you don't smoke and you don't drink. If you do, maybe not 5 things, maybe 6 things. That is the key. My point is, what you're talking about is how do we stay healthy, right? That is the million-dollar question. How do we stay healthy? And this is the focus that we are, sort of the new focus is, can we focus on these things? I think if you look at current epidemic of people going to the hospital, if you see half the admissions, if you really look at half the admissions are related to smoking and alcohol, and maybe now opioids. My point is sort of, I hate to use the word, not all of them are self-induced, but if you look at the trend that is going on, it is sort of man-made, technically speaking. The smoking alcohol was the big thing, and I think we are paying a price for that now. And then the opioids were sort of, you know, pain created. Pain is not a good thing, but we were trying to manage it, and I think that is what we see. The huge expense, yes.
I'm very healthy.
When
I go to the doctor, or some doctor, like a podiatrist and stuff, they ask me if I've had my flu vaccine, the pneumonia vaccine, and other questions, and I say no. They ask me if I'm planning on getting it, and I say no. Say yes.
I don't think they should guess, it's personal choice.
I mean,
we live in a free country. That's why we all come here. So knowledge is key. You know the knowledge, right? So if the question is, these questions have to be asked. My point is, we know benefits of that. Again, we are talking about population. See, individuals are different. Currently, today, all we talked about was population. If you do all this, it is herd immunity. This is what we talk about. You know.
I never drank and I never smoke.
A plus.
Until
the
hour
will
die.
Yeah.
So I'm all set. My
halo
is
going to
slide down and choke me sometime.
Hey, as long as you're happy with that, as long as you don't feel lonely with it, you're okay. Yes.
Wearing a wearable
early kidney disease that they were able to treat because it was caught early.
We are going to learn a lot. My point is, it's going to actually measure your sodium. It's going to measure how much you. Again, these are all coming. It's going to be a completely different way, the way we are practicing medicine today versus, you know, you'll be coming to the office, and instead of taking your blood pressure, you take your phone or whatever iWatch. It's going to plug it into our computer and say, all right, red flag, bing, 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 you know. Time to get the vaccine. Well, that was a joke. Not, you won't tell me about the vaccine, but at least it'll tell us that some intervention needs to be done. And I think it's going to tell us maybe what we are looking for is a day before, a few hours before people actually get sick, right? We all know when the illness actually starts, and then there is this little hinge of, you know, do I go, do I not go, is it a false sign, is it not? And I think that's what needs to be clarified is, should you listen to your brain? Is it the brain really smart, or is it pretty dumb, and then you should listen to the variable? You know, these are all new questions that are coming up, because there is really the science coming up. The brain is actually pretty dumb. We think we are smart, but it's pretty dumb. We don't use as much as we're supposed to use. So the variable is going to sort of guide you to say, for the wake-up call, it's going to say, listen, 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 listen. And again, as human beings, we have difficulty listening.
So you think those are wise investments?
I don't know if they're wise yet. No, because I think the question is how much should I get the upgrade, right? My point is, we are not there yet currently. It tells you the steps, it tells you, you know, where you've gone. I think it's a good thing available. It's going to be the new watch, whatever you want to call it. It's the new timekeeper. Yes?
I just read in the paper, I think it was today, I looked behind my papers, that if you've gone in the hospital and had some serious operation, that your brain does not come out as top shelf as it used to.
God, we just talked about it. You have a new shelf. Yeah, you go to the hospital, you got a new shelf, but it's a lower shelf. You didn't get the top level. You came out because you went through a crisis. You went through an earthquake. Your house is not going to be the same once you have an earthquake right under your house. And I think that is what this whole concept, we are really trying to figure out human body. My point is, yes, we want you to recover to your pre-illness, whatever it was. But the body between anesthesia, there is a new normal. What that new normal is based on what you take to the hospital. Your new normal could be this low, your new normal could be this low. Yes?
Back to the pain management.
How do you
feel about medical marijuana?
Good question. We can afford it, try it.
Yeah.
We can afford it. So I think it's going to be in the same category as some, again, there is going to be some misuse, some appropriate use. The advantage here is I'm not writing the script, so they can't tell me, Sandeep, you got them all hooked up. I really did. So I tell people I'm out of it. My point is, and there is no dosage. When you go to the medical marijuana doctors, there is no dosage they prescribe. They say, okay, to take medical marijuana, they only give you a max. And then when you go to the dispensary sort of dispenses a little bit at a time and sort of helps you out to find out which medical marijuana is going to work for you. There is two different kinds. One has got a little bit more of the high, and the other one is more for pain and sleep and anxiety. I've had some people that have had remarkable success with it, in the sense, not pain. Please understand, I'm not going to talk about pain. Pain causes anxiety, pain causes you to not sleep well. I think what it does is it makes people sleep a little bit better. You feel less anxious, you feel less tired. I think there is a little bit more acceptance to the pain. I'm not sure if pain goes anywhere. Once you have pain, pain is not going anywhere. It is there, we are just masking it. Because it's majority of my patients is related to a degenerative process. If you talk about postherpetic neuralgia, the nerve is angry. No matter how much you take, the nerve is still pretty angry. All we're doing is numbing the brain up for a little while so the crisis sort of settles down. And I think that is what we are understanding more about pain is, pain is there, we can help, but maybe the way we were helping was not the smartest way we were helping our patients. And we learn too. I think that is why we call it practicing medicine. We practice, we learn, and then we change. And I think that is it. New data comes out. So the way we learn is new data comes out, like the vaccine data is going to come out, and then we learn. My point is, and I think this is, it's a team sport. Anybody who comes to my office, we talk about it. It's a team sport. Talk to me. We work together. We get somewhere. And hopefully it's in a safe way. My point is, all the correct answers are not there because if you really think how we are making decisions based on 15-20% of the knowledge we're making the decision. The
human body is so complex. If you sit and think about how complex it is, you are never going to make any decision. So we sort of try to move on with a little bit of understanding. Looks like, and that is why we have clinical trials. The other 50 people who went through this did okay. You know, you were not in the trial. And so that is why we have to really always take that into consideration. You were not in the trial. There were other 50 people like you who were in the trial. And we are making judgment based on those other 50 people who have a completely different genetic code. And we clearly understand that. And that is why we never promise this is going to work great for you. This will work. I don't know. All right? Yes?
I have a question on antidepressants. Is that an appropriate topic?
Oh, sure. Pain, man. Anything that causes pain, we can talk about it.
Okay. On an antidepressant, do they become less effective if you've been taking the same dosage over a number of years?
That's a million-dollar question. So the answer is either less effective or your body gets dependent. So those are two separate questions, and I think we have difficulty answering those. That is why they switch around. The question is now, do you need a different pathway? And then, oh, that pathway was so, the road was so overused, right? The road was so overused that you can't drive on it anymore. And then the question is, do you use a different one, different pathway? So we have the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, we have SNRI, we have dopamine serotonin pathway. So we have different pathways. So there are two ways of looking at it. Is, you know, one, do you need more dose, or do you need a different direction, different road for a little while? And then we've seen this, people go back on this road and it works again. So that's the approach on using the antidepressant. And then sometimes, that is why the whole Abilify thing, where you need the road to be paved a little bit extra, like, you know, if you're taking an antidepressant and it's not working enough, add Abilify. I'm sure everybody's seen the ad on television there. That is, pave the road a little bit better. Maybe that is why the antidepressant is working. All right? Thank you. Thank you very much, guys. Thanks for the